Hi folks, welcome back again this week. This week, we want to discuss choice or free will. There's a lot of people who they seem to think that it's not free will, it's God manipulating us to do his will. Well, that's not correct.
No.
In the garden, God gave Adam and Eve choice, didn't he? Mm-hmm. He put the knowledge of good and evil in the garden, and he said, don't touch. The day you touch of it, you will die. And he left it at that. He didn't remove the knowledge of good and evil from the garden. It was there. If that's not the greatest example of free will, of God giving us free will choice, I don't know what is. Because we've had choice even in the garden, where, remember, the tree of life was in the garden, and they were allowed to eat of any tree in the garden except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's the only tree that they couldn't eat of. So they were, the tree of life was there. They were immortal in the garden. And what did it cost them when they disobeyed? When they made a choice, you know, Eve, of course, emotion really played a big role because the devil tempted her with the idea that she could be just like God. And, oh boy, that's tempting, isn't it, eh? I get to be boss. I get to play God. I get to be the all-knowing one. And that deception has never changed. That deception holds true right to the end. That is the great deception, is that man can play God. So she ate. Emotion lusted to become like God. She ate. She chose. Of her own free will. And the price to be paid? She died. She lost her immortality and put on mortality. So, in discussing choice, keep all that in mind.
And also, which I think we probably mentioned it last week too, the Lord specifies multiple times that he is making a people unto himself. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to be with someone that is being forced to be with them.
That's right.
Nobody wants somebody who's been brainwashed. Nobody wants a robot. You want your friends to be around you because they care about you and they like you. You want your partner to be around you because they love you and they want to be with you. So it would kind of make everything pointless if we had no free will and no choice, and God just dictated to us what we were or weren't going to do or think or say or speak or feel about him, yeah. Everything would just be pointless.
Yeah, absolutely. So, looking at Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, there's a lot of people, they believe only in what a supposedly good man did for them. That's their form of Christianity, sort of. What someone else did for them. And they don't give consideration to the eternal God. Remember? Father Truth. And what he did for his creation. What he did for us. So they remain ignorant of the Father. They claim to possess the Son, but the Son said, Jesus said, if you know me, you'll know the Father. I'll show the Father to you. John 17:3, now this is eternal life, that they may know you, Heavenly Father, and Jesus Christ, whom you sent. So it's not just knowing Jesus as Messiah, it's understanding who the Father is. And again, back, it's not believing in what a supposedly good man did for them, for us. It's giving consideration to what the eternal God did for his creation. The huge difference there.
Which again, when people get this wrong, again, it's not even logical, because who wants a God that would sacrifice someone else to make happen what he wants to make happen when he's fully capable of doing it himself? Again, it goes against everything. If truth and love is God, it goes against that. It can't be. So I don't even understand why people, how they can even see that as a possibility, that God created someone and said, okay, this is really going to suck, but I'm going to need you to go do this for me. That, you know, it just doesn't...
It's illogical.
Doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
Speaking of choice, though, I don't know if this is the place for it, but I don't want us to not do it. So keeping in mind that Jesus is God himself.
Yeah.
It was God who came and did the deed. It wasn't someone like you or me or some righteous prophet or someone created for that particular purpose in life.
That's right.
It was God himself that made himself mortal and went through that horrific deed for his creation. And remember, it was for all of creation. Not everyone accepts the gift, but the gift is given freely to everyone.
Remember choice.
Yeah, Jesus died for everyone.
Yeah.
If people choose not to accept the gift of salvation, that's their choice and that's their problem. But God gave it for everyone.
They condemn themselves in making the wrong choice.
Mm-hmm.
Adam and Eve condemned themselves to death by making the wrong choice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also, speaking of choice, because everyone has choice, including God. God didn't have to, when he saw that we were kind of a miserable creation, that, you know, we F stuff up all the time, constantly. God had a choice. He could have just wiped us all off the face of the earth and started over.
It's not like he hasn't done that in the past, is it?
Right.
Remember the flood?
Yeah. So it was, he also had a choice whether or not to come in the flesh and die and be the salvation for everyone. As is posed in Matthew 26:39, Jesus is praying in the garden. Going a little farther, he fell on his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Now, he's not praying to somebody else. I like the way I would pray to you because you're my dad. No. Is he praying to himself? No. Yes. Yes. For effect, because there are people around who are listening.
Ah, okay.
And he has not yet died and been resurrected. He is praying to truth. In the every time in the Old Testament, that Lord in all caps, don't think of that as like some person sitting on a throne. When it says that God hardened Pharaoh's heart, it doesn't mean that God, Jesus, the form, took away Pharaoh's choice and made him make the choice to not let the Israelites go. It means that the truth, in the absence of any love, just truth, which shows no favoritism.
Abaddon.
The truth of the matter was, if Pharaoh wanted to be in power and rule Egypt, he needed the Israelites as slaves, and letting them go would have destroyed his entire enterprise.
And he realized that.
Yeah, so when it says that the Lord hardened his heart, the truth of the matter hardened his heart, and he couldn't let his slaves go because it would have meant the end of him. So in the same way, Jesus is not praying to another person. The truth of the matter is, he's already decided that he's going to do this and die for his creation. It's been written down. He's there. He's there to do that job, the job that he set out for himself and the job that he is choosing to do. But he is also making it very clear to the disciples and hopefully to the rest of us, if we're listening when we read this 2,000 years later, he didn't want to do this. This was not a fun thing.
No.
He wanted to save his creation, so he did do it. But the point of that verse, I think, is to show us this is how much he loved us, that he knew it was going to suck. He didn't have to do it. He made the choice to do it.
Yeah.
And he did.
Yeah. So what choices do we make?
Yeah.
What is this, have I got on here? I can't quite see
Fear of the Lord. Obedient servant.
If
he refuses, I will not be pleased. Support that servant says.
Okay, that's the verse I'm looking for.
Okay, so that's on your, should be up on your Bible, I think.
I don't think we found that, did we?
Well, you found what you thought was enough, the Ephesians one, I think.
Luke 17:7. Luke. Luke 17, 7 to 10. Suppose one of you had a servant plowing or looking after the sheep. Would he say to that servant when he comes in from the field, come along now and sit down and eat? Would he not rather say to that servant, prepare my supper, get yourself ready, and wait on me while I eat and drink? After that, you may eat and drink. Would he thank the servant because he did what he was told to do? So you also, when you have done everything you were told to do, should say, we are unworthy servants. We have only done our duty. That's important. Mm-hmm. A lot of people seem to think, well, I'll just come to Jesus. Right. I'll listen to what the supposed shepherds, who are actually wolves in sheep's clothing, fleecing, living off the sheep. I'll listen to what they say, and then I'm saved, and that's it, that's all. I'll forget about everything else. I won't go into training. I won't study. I won't try and understand. I won't fall in love with the Bible and read it, you know, constantly to get nourishment from it.
And we were already in the garden. We got the boot because we did something wrong. This is our punishment.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are living out your punishment and you do what you should have been doing when you were still in the garden that you weren't doing, so you got kicked out. You want a participation trophy for doing your duty?
Yeah.
The whole reason that you're in this mess in the first place is because you messed up. We got the boot.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Are we going to get, should we be getting praise for doing our duty? Our duty of like the only thing that God told us not to do in the first place?
So we should be going into training. Don't forget, grace, the grace of God is coming to an end. It's called the age of grace, and it is coming to an end. The first spirit of the sevenfold spirit of God that stand before the throne of God is the spirit of grace. And at Ephesus, this is what it shows us. And it says that if you forget your first love, I'll take your lampstand away. Well, if you don't have a lampstand, you have no light. And light is understanding. If he takes our lampstand away, he returns us to darkness. Darkness is ignorance. Darkness is death. Light is life.
Mm-hmm.
So people who just embrace the religious concept, you know, the organized religious ideal of Christendom, and don't go any farther, well, they don't understand anything. They're walking in darkness. And to walk in darkness is to die. Bad choice. Don't forget your first love. Don't forget, at the Spirit of Grace, you had the right to eat of the Tree of Life. the right to eat. But you don't get the crown of life, oh, now I've eaten, until after the second church. Ephesus, Smyrna?
Yep.
And this is what Smyrna is talking about, the letter to Smyrna.
So basically,
it's revealing the second spirit of God, which is the spirit of truth.
So basically, the grace at Ephesus is Jesus went to the cross.
Yeah.
Now here is salvation. Smyrna, the second church, is recognizing what we were talking about in the beginning. It wasn't some man that came and did something for us. It was God himself. It's our recognition and our acknowledgement that Jesus is God himself who went to the cross.
Yeah.
That saves you.
It wasn't a man that saved us.
No.
It says that Jesus is the creator. Mm-hmm. That all things were created by him and for him and through him. That nothing was created that has been created that wasn't created by Jesus. Remember, Father, truth, the mind of God, his spirit, his desire, love, the heart of God, his son, Jesus, the Messiah, the Christ, the form of God. And remember, where is Jesus today?
In us, in his people.
He's in his people. Do you understand that? If Jesus comes back as the Son of Man, and the Son of Man represents that which is mortal, and the Son of God represents that which is immortal. Remember, Jesus called himself the Son of Man, but after he rose from the dead, he acknowledged he was the Son of God. He's immortal. He's the eternal creator. Jesus is the Ancient of Days. So Father, truth, his spirit, love, his son, the form of God. Jesus comes back as the Son of Man. Remember that. Where do you find Jesus today? In his people. Remember that. Let's look at a few more scriptures here. Mindy, would you read for us Colossians 1, 24 to 29?
I think you should maybe do the Ephesians one first.
You think? Which one?
Let me just look it up.
The 6:13?
I think that. I'm gonna look that one up. You look up the next one. Yeah, 3:7.
Ephesians 3:7-9. Ephesians is written by Paul, and he says, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace, given me through the working of his power. Now remember, the power of God is the gospel. And what is the gospel? Well, it's the revealing of God, Father Truth, and his Christ, truth, in bodily form. Even truth and his spirit love in us. Although I am less than the least of all God's people, this is Paul speaking, this grace was given to me to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God, who created all things. Well, what is this mystery?
Well, we'll get to that. That's in my verse.
Okay.
That's why I wanted you to go first.
Do you
want
to read that one first?
You're not done, though, are you?
I think.
You are. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Where are you?
This is still Paul. It's Colossians 1, 24 to 29. Now I rejoice in what was suffered for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church. I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. To this end I labor, struggling with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me.
Do you catch that? What is the mystery? It's Christ in us.
Yeah.
Does that make us God?
No.
No.
No, it's the understanding of the Trinity.
Yes.
How you have a mind, a spirit, and a form. And how Jesus is the Father, but also truth is the Father.
Yeah.
Something that's...
Jesus is the form of truth.
Yes.
Or the form in whom truth dwells.
Mm-hmm.
Truth and love should dwell in us.
Yeah.
And when truth and love dwells in us, and we understand truth, because we've studied, we've shown ourselves approved as workmen capable in the Word of God, then we speak the truth. We rebuke, we correct, we encourage with all patience. Don't forget the love part. With all patience and long suffering and perseverance and persistence to help others understand the same and behave appropriately.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if truth and love is the God, Jesus is his name, is the God we serve or claim to serve, what the hell are people doing climbing into bed with falsehood, who encourages hatred of truth, he denies the truth, and who encourages hatred of against your fellow man? Why would we climb into bed and copulate with the devil? Falsehood. Why? We'd be hypocrites, wouldn't we?
Yeah.
We'd be an unfaithful bride, wouldn't we? If we're the betrothed of God himself, if we're God's bride, and we're found to have climbed into bed with falsehood and hatred and copulated with the devil to produce the children of the devil, the spawn of Satan, boy, I'll tell you, that's an adulterous bride, isn't it? She's a friggin' whore. That's the problem with organized religion.
And again, the importance of realizing that it wasn't a man that came and did something.
That's right.
Because when you look at it in these terms, and bring it down to a literal level so that you can understand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, look at it in a natural way. Why would you ever want to go along with the devil and thumb your nose at God when truth and love in his form died for you,
yeah,
suffered, continues to suffer because we continually reject him all the time. Every time that you choose falsehood and hatred over truth and love, you're just hurting God. That's what we're doing.
Well, talks
about grieving the Spirit.
Yeah.
Grieving the Spirit is not blaspheming the Spirit, but don't think that the Lord enjoys the grieving part.
No.
If I disappoint you or I tell you I think you're a piece of shit today, it doesn't feel very good.
No.
You know? Well, God is also a person. Jesus is a real person. And it's God himself. I don't think he appreciates it when we do things like that. And he's got to sit there and watch what we're doing and think, boy, look at all that I've done for you. Giving even my life, making myself mortal to give you my life. And all I have asked is that you acknowledge that I did it for you.
Yeah.
That's it.
And follow him.
Yeah, follow him. Love your neighbor the way that I love you. You keep messing up, I keep forgiving you.
Yeah.
You know.
And so we should forgive our neighbor.
Yeah, absolutely.
Except for blaspheming the Spirit.
Yeah.
That's...
Well, because God doesn't forgive that.
That's Hebrews 6:4-6. It is impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have understood, tasted of the goodness of the Word of God, understood the power of truth, the power of God himself, and to turn around and deny that, no, he stands condemned. There is no forgiveness. That sin is not forgiven. It's the only sin that is not forgiven. But you have to have first been enlightened. You have to have heard the gospel preached that is the right gospel. Not the perversions that are so popular to tickle men's imaginations. We stick with the gospel we preach, truth and love in bodily form. And he in us, the mystery of Christ, truth and love, Father and his Spirit in us. It's important. It's important. Let's read Ephesians. Whereabouts are we? 6:13-18. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, which is quite often, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything, to actually stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted for the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. Remember? Truth and unconditional love in us. Be at peace. People are what they are, and they are what they are through choice, and their choices are made from what they understand, for what they think they understand. If we operate in the power of God, which is the gospel, and we bring to them the correct understanding, we operate in the power of God. And the power of God has the ability to change people's opinions, to change their choices to the positive rather than the negative all the time. So your shoes fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Faith is simply practicing what you preach. Make sure you understand what you preach. And you can lift that shield of faith. And when the arrows of the evil one come at us, the words of criticism and persecution and ridicule, you know, condemnation, we recognize where they're coming from. We recognize why they're coming. And we operate in the power of God. Watch. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit. Remember, God is spirit, 1 John 5:6. This spirit, no, excuse me. God is spirit, John 4:24. This spirit we call God is truth, 1 John 5:6. Take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. If you don't know the Word of God, if you've never even bothered to pick it up, so many people walk around with a Bible under their arm and say, I'm wise. They don't have a clue what it says in this book. They've never read it. Are they wise? No. No, they're not wise. They're foolish. Very foolish. Study to show yourself approved, a workman who handles the Word of God correctly. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Do you see the power of God? It is the truth revealed. It is also called the fire of God. That's why often you'll see artists depict God with a flaming sword proceeding from his mouth. The truth destroys falsehood, lies, innuendo, hypocrisy. The truth destroys all that. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. Let's go to Matthew 25:29-30. 25:29, is that what I said?
Mm-hmm.
For everyone who has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Of what? Well, we're talking about the bread of life here. The Holy Scriptures, understanding the Holy Scriptures. Whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken from him. Remember I said the age of grace is coming to an end. Remember Ephesus. You've forgotten your first love.
Yeah. Take away your lampstand.
I'll take away your lampstand and return you to darkness. Your first love. The only reason we know about Jesus, the only reason we understand God is because of the Holy Scriptures. Even what he has will be taken from him, and throw that worthless servant outside into darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Oh crap, that's the lake of fire. Where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Bad news. Bad news. So do we have choice or don't we? Are we a bunch of little pawns being led around by the nose? No. No. And if we are being led around by the nose, it's
by the devil.
It's only of our own bad choices. Remember that Abaddon or Apollyon, the destroyer, it is truth in the absence of love. Father Truth alone, he shows no favoritism. Don't say that God shows me favoritism, because he doesn't. He doesn't. He wants me to be saved. He wants me to follow him in the same way he wants the most wicked person on the face of the earth to be saved and to follow him. Truth is inflexible. Truth never changes his mind. Truth never lies. So truth alone, boy, don't go against them, because there is a consequence for going against truth.
Well, that's why we're supposed to fear the Lord.
Exactly. That's why we fear God.
If the fire's hot and you put your hand in it,
you're going to get burned.
Everyone's going to get burned. No matter who you are or what God thinks of you, you're going to get burned.
Yep.
And you should fear the fact that the fire's hot.
Yeah. Yeah. We're not preaching to you anything that's too difficult to understand. This is all totally logical. Totally relevant.
But keep in mind that only God gives understanding.
So, to those who are sincerely seek him.
So if someone doesn't understand it, there's work for you to do in asking God.
Help them understand.
Yeah.
Whatever, how does it share? I think it's in one of the Timothys. Share. That's the only thing I can think of, and I think it's in one of the Timothys. So let's just roll down and see if we can find it. Well, there's 1 Timothy. Let's see what it says there. Share in the sins of others. No. Willing to share. Receive a share in the crop. No, that didn't come up.
Well, there's another. There was also 2 Timothy. So go back to the menu.
Yeah, that's where I am right now. Oh, back one. 2 Timothy.
Okay.
Whereabouts is that? Huh. Whoever is taught by the word should share all good things. Share good. Let's see what that brings up. Galatians. Oh, there it is. I was wrong. It's not in one of the Timothys. It's in Galatians. Anyone who receives instruction in the word must share all good things with his instructor. Now, if we have fellowship with one another, who is our instructor? Wendy and I, we share constantly between each other. Wendy shares with her friend. They discuss, read Bible scriptures and discuss things. They share with one another what God has shared with them. Remember, anyone who has received instruction in the Word must share all good things with his instructor. It's Galatians 6:6. So we don't think ourselves better than others in that, oh, I understand stuff and those fools don't, but I'm not sharing it with them. No, we should be eager to share with one another. This is fellowship. Yep. When we share with one another and instruct each other. Remember, Jesus may well be in me, but I can't forget that Jesus is in Wendy too. So if Wendy's got something to say, I best be listening to what she's got to say too. And we'll test whatever conclusions we draw, we'll test them against the Word of God to see what God has to say in His Word and who He agrees with. Even Wendy and I, who both understand the two sides to wisdom, who understand the languages of the prophets, and who can identify this is the literal understanding and that's the spiritual understanding, even in that situation, we still get the final word from the Word of God. Yep. This is what came to life in flesh. The prophets prophesied that the Christ would come and what the Christ would do. And Jesus told us that that's who sent him. He said, I don't speak on my own. I speak what the Father has taught me. Yep. What the prophets have said. I'm fulfilling it.
Well, and as it says, no servant is greater than his master, and no part of creation died in place of the Creator.
That's right.
Creator did it himself.
The Creator did it himself. Jesus is Lord. And if I were writing that down, it would all be capital letters. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. They're quick to do that in the Old Testament when they're identifying the Father. But in the New Testament, because of their ignorance of God, no, they don't. Jesus is not identified with all caps. Well, guess what? He should be. I identify him as all caps. Anyways, I hope that's been helpful a little bit. Lord willing, we hope to see you again next week. I encourage everyone, read your Bible. Ask the Lord for understanding. He'll make it clear to you as to what He's talking about. He'll make it clear. Remember, there's no contradictions in the Bible. So if what you think something is saying contradicts with something else that you've read in the Bible, something's wrong. You're probably looking at it from the literal rather than the spiritual, because there are no contradictions. We love you all. Bye for now.